Great pleasure to be here. And yeah, we change now from muscles, from nerves to the central nervous system, especially to transcranial diacrine stimulation. So why it's interesting to talk about this, when you look at the number of publications in the field, you can see from the year where we started, so about 2000, you can see, so this is only until 2016, but it further increases. You see a large increase of a number of publications which deal with effects of this stimulation technique. And so there must be something, some reason for it. And one reason is, I think, that with this stimulation techniques, I will show you later a bit more in detail, you induce neuroplasticity. Neuroplasticity, so the modification of the strength of synaptic connections, is a very basic physiological mechanism of the human brain, tightly involved in learning, memory formation, and so on. And if you think also about pathological alterations of activity and excitability, then plasticity also plays a role. So there should be a clinical, so not only a potential with respect to exploring these basic mechanisms in the human brain and its relevance for learning, memory formation, for other cognitive functions, but also for clinical application. So that's one reason why we see this increase of publications. In the clinical field, we had in the first years mainly pilot studies, so exploring the field where could the stimulation be advantageous. We have now an increased number of studies in the last years aiming for clinical meaningful effects, but we have heterogeneous quality of studies. And then, of course, kind of techniques you need for clinical applications and the protocols you need for clinical applications are different compared to those you need for basic studies. In basic studies, it's sufficient if you have some short-lasting effects, plasticity which lasts maybe for 1 or 2 hours. What you want to have in clinical applications are longer-lasting effects. So that's the reason for the question, how can we define protocols which are optimally suited to achieve clear therapeutic effects. And if you look at the clinical state of application of TDCS, this becomes even more clear, I think. So this is an overview of Le Faucheur and colleagues from 2017 who put together all the clinical studies of TDCS. And if you look at the evidence we have currently, then we have reasonable evidence for application of TDCS in pain syndromes, so chronic neuropathic pain, fibromyalgia, also in tinnitus, depression, and addiction and craving. But for many other syndromes, at least at this year, it was not so clear. So there was no clear evidence for specific effects. And for this, of course, if you see the potential of the techniques, optimization is important. So what's the principal mechanism of action? So first, how we apply this, so you can see that we are doing this now already since 20 years or something like this. And when you look at the change during the years, you might doubt if it helps a lot for aging. So it's a relatively weak stimulation. We started with these relatively large electrodes here, stimulated here the motor cortex with one electrode, return electrode at another position. And we stimulate with these electrodes with an intensity of 1 milliamp or 2 milliamp. So that's relatively low intensity. You don't feel pain or something like this as compared to super threshold electrical stimulation, where you have to stimulate between 300, 700 volts to get an super threshold activation of cortical areas. What we are doing is we are inducing a substress threshold modulation of resting membrane potentials. So dependent on the polarity of stimulation, we hyperpolarize or we depolarize neuronal membranes. Since we are at a sub-threshold level, this doesn't induce action potentials, but if you think about that your brain is always active, always spontaneous activity takes place, you have a modulation of spontaneous activity. It's, you need less incoming activity if you depolarize the resting membrane potentials to induce an action potentials. As compared to the basic level, and if you hyperpolarize, you need more activity. So spontaneous activity is altered by the stimulation. And if you think about clinical applications, then the most important effect is not this acute impact on spontaneous neuronal activity, but the impact we have on neuroplasticity. And when we stimulate for between 5 and 30 minutes here with the anode over the target area, this motor cortex, it's a motor cortex study where we looked for the amplitude of motor evoked potentials, and the amplitude is an index for excitability. You can see here that we get an excitability enhancement, which lasts for about 1 hour or a bit longer after the end of stimulation. You can see also that the efficiency depends on stimulation duration. 5 minutes, 10 minutes gives you relatively short effects. Longer stimulation gives you longer lasting effects. And you switch the polarity of stimulation here with the cathode over the motor cortex, we get long lasting excitability diminutions in the motor cortex, so reduction of MEP amplitudes. So that's the basic effects we see with TDCS. We have in the last years done numerous studies looking for the mechanism of actions here, and don't have the time now to show you all these pharmacological studies, but what we found is that we induce plasticity of glutamatergic synapses. GABA seems to be a kind of counterplayer of glutamatergic activity. Neuromodulators play a role in the effects, but it's plasticity of these synapses, glutamatergic synapses, NMDA receptors are important. And the mechanism of plasticity we induce here is that dependent on the polarity of stimulation, we enhance or we reduce calcium concentration. This results then in a modification of the concentration of AMPA receptors in the subsynaptic membrane. With high calcium concentration, you enhance number of AMPA receptors. With low calcium concentration, reduce number of AMPA receptors. And you can imagine that the more of these receptors you have, the easier it is for an incoming signal to induce an action potential at the subsynaptic membrane. So if you enhance the number of AMPA receptors, you enhance excitability, or you enhance the potential for activation of the synapse. That this kind of plasticity is calcium dependent is important also for optimization. So it's known that with low calcium concentration, long-term depression is induced, so this reduction of cortical excitability and weakening of synaptic connections, whereas with high calcium concentration, you induce long-term potentiation. You have a kind of no man's land, so an intermediate zone where you don't induce plasticity by the stimulation, and there are also mechanisms which prevent calcium overflow, which otherwise would reduce in would result in neuronal death. So you have this calcium-dependent qualitative differences of plasticity. So for optimization of your stimulation protocols, then alteration of the strength of stimulation might be attractive to enhance efficiency of the stimulation. And we have done this already relatively early, so applied here for 5 minutes different stimulation intensities between 0.2 and 1 milliamp, and got with stronger stimulation better effects. Also what I showed you before already, with longer stimulation we got better effects of the stimulation, so a more profound and prolonged enhancement of MEP amplitudes. And this makes sense because when we are here in the range of LTP and we enhance duration and intensity of stimulation, we should enhance calcium concentration, and so we should get better effects here. This works within this window of intensity and duration of stimulation, so for up to maybe 20 minutes. But I've showed you already these non-linearities of the effects of calcium concentration. And this means also if you leave this window, and we stimulated here not for 13 minutes, so this was for 13 minutes with the anode excitability enhancement, but we simply doubled the stimulation duration, and then we got an excitability diminution. So we got a switch of the direction of the effects of TDCS. So we thought that this might be due that we are somewhere here, so in a calcium concentration which activates mechanism, which reduce plasticity, to avoid damaging effects. So we reduce calcium concentration here with this 26 minutes stimulation protocol with flunarizine, which is a calcium channel blocker. And then you see that this inhibition no longer takes place. So this switch from excitability enhancement to reduction seems to be indeed also a calcium-dependent mechanism. And you can see a similar thing with Castleford TDCS, a study conducted by Georgi Batsikadze some years ago in our laboratory. Here we stimulated 20 minutes with 1 milliamp stimulation with the cathode, and here it was 20 minutes with 2 milliamp stimulation. You can see also here the switch of directionality of the effects, most probably due to that we go with the stimulation protocol, stronger stimulation, we move from calcium concentration which induces LTD to calcium concentration which induces LTP. And this of course makes things a bit complicated, and the question is then how can we improve the efficiency of the stimulation? So it's not unexpected that we have this nonlinear effects, because TCS is a new modulatory intervention, so it's not new modulators which act on a brain state have normally nonlinear effects. So similar, for example, if you think about dopamine as a new pharmacological neuromodulator, you have these nonlinearities. We have maybe also, and we have inter-individual differences of effects. So the question is how to solve this. And I want to show you some options how to optimize the stimulation protocols by optimization of stimulation parameters, and also some early results on the development of individualized protocols which take into account individually different brain states. So we have, and this makes things also a bit problematic, we have lots of parameters we can optimize in case of non-invasive brain stimulation, including TDCS. We can modulate intensity, duration, I've shown you this, we can modulate, or we can repeat stimulation and can change repetition rates. We have regional effects of stimulation, but also network effects, so we have a kind of huge parameter space. And in the first group of studies, we started with intensifying stimulation intensity and also prolonging stimulation duration. So in two studies, we stimulated between 1 and 3 milliamp, between 15 and 30 minutes, so we extended the parameter space of stimulation a bit. Our model area was the primary motor cortex. We obtained cortical excitability, monitored it by TMS-evoked motor-evoked potentials, and we followed up excitability changes for more than 24 hours, so next evening after the day of stimulation. And what we could show for anodal TDCS, for cathodal TDCS, was that we had, again, this non-linearity of effect. So you can see here stimulation with 1 milliamp, where we largely independent from the stimulation duration, we got excitability diminution, maybe a bit larger effects with longer stimulation. With 3 milliamp, we again got this excitability diminution. But with 2 milliamp, we got, especially with 20 minute stimulation, we again got this excitability enhancement. And this is in a way important, this information, because it shows that it might be not a very good idea, at least in the groups we studied, to stimulate with this stimulation intensity if you want to get an excitability diminution. Question is, why do we get this excitability reduction here again? And two options: if you stimulate still stronger, you might be efficient in deeper cortical regions as compared to weaker stimulations, so you might recruit different neurons. And another option is that you have a kind of secondary inhibition after this excitability enhancement, so LTP range, you have this calcium overflow to prevent this, you have counter-regulatory mechanisms, so this might be also a reason. We have done recently one study where we applied here again a calcium channel blocker. You didn't see this inhibition there anymore, and that's a relatively, and the effect switched again into facilitation. And so this shows that this might indeed partially at least be antagonism against calcium overflow, which then would mean that if you want to have primary long-term depression, you might want to go to the 1 milliamp stimulation protocols. We have more homogeneous effects with anodal TDCS, so independent or largely independent from stimulation intensity and duration, we get always this excitability enhancement. So with 15, 20, and also with 30 minutes stimulation, you can see here when you compare variability and effect size, that with 3 milliamp we get somewhat bigger effects. The red curve is 20 minutes stimulation, so gradually there seem to be also better effects with 20 minutes stimulation. But this shows, and this was also shown in a former study, that for the effects of excitability enhancing anodal TDCS, intensity range which gives you linear effects is a bit larger. Okay, so I've shown you so far that we have nonlinear effects of anodal and cathodal TDCS at the group level. Prolongation of stimulation duration can be efficient. Stronger stimulation is efficient. So we have this, of course, at the group level. And one next question is this valid also for effects in individuals, where we have certain kind of variability? So that's a study from Asif Yamil, conducted in our laboratory also some time ago, shows similar effects that different intensities of anodal TCS here with 0.5 up to 2 milliamp give us an excitability enhancement. It's cathodal TDCS here, only 1 milliamp stimulation gives us a significant excitability diminution. And one further aspect of the study was when he repeated stimulation. So this was 1 milliamp stimulation for 15 minutes in a couple of these subjects who contributed also to these results. You can see that the effects were relatively stable over time, so we had an intra-class correlation of 0.8, and the interval between these stimulations was sometimes some months, so we have inter-individually relatively stable effects. But we have, for anodal TDCS, different effects in subgroups. What we did here was that we divided the group into two subgroups. One group which high sensitivity to TMS, so a relatively high baseline excitability, and the other group had low sensitivity, so lower excitability of the brain before TDCS. And when we then look for the different stimulation intensities, then you see that the groups with higher sensitivity for TMS, so higher baseline excitability, profited more from lower intensity of TDCS with regard to excitability enhancement, and a bit less with higher TDCS intensities, whereas the group who had less excitability at the baseline level profited more from higher TDCS intensities. So this might be that's a compound parameter, of course, which is determined by electrode to brain distance, by the microscopic architecture of the brain, by receptor and transmitter composition. But it might be that this compound measure is helpful to determine which, in future, to determine which stimulation intensity has optimal effects in a specific individual. So we are relatively at the beginning here, so that's not ready for application, but this might be a way to go. Okay, so what this shows also is that enhancing stimulation intensity does not, in each case, in each individual, improve efficiency of TDCS. We have intra-individually relatively stable effects, but we have this inter-individual variability, and lower TMS sensitivity might require or requires higher TDCS intensities to get similar effects. Okay, so these were more or less the titration and parameter studies, so how to enhance efficiency, and we have a couple of other options which I want to show you shortly. So one option is specific intervals of repetition of stimulation. And what we did here is, I hope this doesn't cause problems, no? Too much stimulation for the projector. Okay, so it's known from animal experiments that if you repeat the stimulation within a specific time window of about 30 minutes, you can get not only this early phase plasticity I showed you, which is defined by excitability alterations which last for about up to 3 hours after stimulation. This is what I've shown you so far. But you can get long-lasting effects, so-called late phase plasticity, which can last for days, weeks, or in animal preparations or animal models even longer. And so we tested this for TDCS in humans, compared here simply doubling stimulation duration from 13 to 26 minutes in case of analytes, as you saw this already, which didn't improve efficiency. Here we had long intervals of 3 hours and 24 hours of repetition. You see here that there's a diminution of effects. And here we had the interval of, an interval of 2 minutes and 20 minutes, 3 minutes and 20 minutes, so within the 30 minutes interval. And you can see here that for another TDCS, we got after effects which last for over 24 hours after the end of stimulation. So transferring the results of animal experiments with respect to specific protocols which induce this late phase plasticity seems to make sense also for plasticity induction in humans. This works for anadrotic TDCS. For casodrotic TDCS, with simply one repetition, you get a bit of stabilization, but not really prolongation of the effects. And if you want to have for clinical application long-lasting effects, this might be a way to go. There are new stimulation protocols available, which make use not only of regional stimulation, but of network stimulation. So the rationale here was to stimulate the motor cortex network. And this was compared with a single small electrode over the motor cortex and a kind of nonsense electrode arrangement. You can see here when you model this that you get here these bilateral effects of stimulation compared to unilateral effects with the one electrode. And what the colleagues saw is that they had with this network stimulation large effects of the stimulation as compared to unilateral stimulation, but the effects were of course also less focused, so they had bilateral effects here with this network stimulation, only unilateral effects with this one electrode. But, it seems to be the case that compared to this small one electrode, that with the network stimulation you get more higher efficiency of the stimulation. I've shown you before shortly that we have also, so pharmacologically glutamatergic plasticity is affected by lots of neuromodulators, and we can also combine stimulation with pharmacological intervention to enhance TDCS-induced plasticity. We can do this, for example, with serotonin reuptake inhibitors. We applied here citalopram, and you can see that the LTP-like effects induced by anadrotTDCS were enhanced. Interestingly, we saw a switch of the excitability diminution induced by casodrotTDCS into excitability enhancement with this combination. This has found already clinical application. The study conducted, published some years ago by Andre Brononi and colleagues, they could show that combination of antidepressant medication with TDCS in depression, in major depression, had relevantly and significantly large effects than any of the interventions alone. We see similar effects also with noradrenaline reuptake inhibitors, also here enhancement of the efficacy of TDCS and switch of casodrotTDCS induced inhibition into facilitation, so this might be another option. And if you want to enhance inhibitory effects of the stimulation, then dopaminergic agents might be a good option. We saw here with pergolide and also with L-DOPA relatively similar effects that you see here, relevant prolongation of the after effects of casodrotTDCS when we combine stimulation here, for example, with 100 milligram L-DOPA. And you see here also a switch of the excitability enhancement induced by anadrotTDCS into an excitability diminution. So combination of pharmacology with stimulation might be also an interesting point. Okay, this just puts this together. I want shortly also to show you that for behavioral effects of the stimulation, optimization and adaptation, also titration, might be an important aspect. So that's a study where subjects learned here to press buttons according to a simple sequence. So sequence motor learning where primary motor cortex is known to be involved. And what I could show here was 1 milliamp stimulation where we got nice plasticity in the motor cortex at the physiological level. They didn't get an effect, but when they enhanced stimulation intensity to 1.5 milliamp, and they had a nice effect, and they had an improving effect on motor sequence learning here. So also here, optimization, adaptation on specific tasks might make sense. We have done a couple of studies with the SRTTs here, reaction time tasks, some time ago. Sequence here of 12 stimuli, 10 times repeated per block, also learned by button presses. And we have here 8 blocks of the stimulation. We have, of course, increasing task routine. We have sequence learning. To discern task routine from sequence learning, we have here a random block. When task routine is identical between both blocks, then reaction time difference between those two blocks should be due to learning of the sequence. And since long-term potentiation should play a role during motor learning and the primary motor cortex is activated during the initial learning phase, we stimulated M1 here during learning and indeed see that with anadrol TDCS we got an enhancement of motor learning, which is restricted to the sequence, so you don't see this here in the random stimulus order. And we get this effect with M1 stimulation, but not with stimulation of the premotor cortex. So timing seems to be here important. We did online stimulation, we didn't get effect with offline stimulation, and also the specific area you stimulate should be relevant for task performance at this time point. Premotor cortex, of course, is involved in motor learning, and there were hints at this time that, and there are still hints that premotor cortex is more relevant for consolidation. This is a study by Marquet and colleagues. Subjects learned also the sequence task before they went to sleep, and then they saw there's a premotor activation during REM sleep. So they had the idea that there's a consolidation of task performance in premotor areas during REM sleep. We tested this also by TDCS via letting the subjects learn the task before they went to sleep. You see here that both groups had similar effects. Then we applied anadrol TDCS during REM sleep, woke the subjects up, and you see here that they had better effects with anadrol TDCS during REM sleep. So for optimization of the effects, it's important not only to have the right intensity and to stimulate the right area, but you have to stimulate also at the right time point when this area is involved in the respective performance. So dose adaptation to task is relevant for optimization, and appropriate timing of stimulation is very relevant to get your effects. To conclude, what we need for optimization of TCS effects is systematic titration, adaptation of stimulation parameters. This might also include individual adaptation of stimulation parameters, spacing, network stimulation, addition of pharmacological agents, further can improve efficiency of the stimulation, and adaptation of dose to task and timing is also important. What we are currently working on is transferability of these effects to other areas and also to patients, of course. We explore currently also mechanisms and determinants of these nonlinear effects in a bit more detail. And that's it so far. Many thanks for your attention. These are all the people who do the work.